поэтому с удовольствием первое слово представляю Стори. Это человек, которого не нужно представлять тем людям, которые читают и следят за событиями, и читают всякую литературу на эту тему, давно и очень квалифицированно выступающий по всем этим вопросам. И поэтому я думаю, мы все его с удовольствием послушаем. Пожалуйста, Рейчик.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much, Gregor, for your kind introduction. I'd like to start by thanking the Institute of Oriental Studies for inviting me for a second time. It's always a pleasure to be in Moscow, and thank you for arranging such good weather for us. Events in the South China Sea every year are generally dominated by one event, and those events can be summed up usually in one word or one phrase. In 2010, it was Hillary Clinton's speech at the ARF. In 2011, it was the cable-cutting incidents off Vietnam. In 2012, it was the Scarborough Shoal crisis. In 2013, it was the Philippines' legal submission to the UN. Last year, events were dominated by the oil rig crisis. And this year, the buzzword is reclamations. And I'm very glad to be speaking first, so that I can be the first one to say reclamations, because I'm sure we'll hear it over and over again for the course of the day. So what I'd like to do in the time available to me is provide a brief overview of the reclamations, their stated and unstated rationales, regional and international reactions, and finally, to consider what these developments might mean for regional security. So, since mid-2013, China has been undertaking a large-scale reclamation work on seven features in the Spratlys under its control. Following the reclamations, extensive infrastructure has been constructed on these reclaimed features, including harbors, radar and surveillance systems, multi-story buildings of various sizes, and airstrips on at least one and possibly two of these features. The largest development, the picture you can see on my right, is at Fiery Cross Reef, where an artificial island of approximately 3,000 meters long and 200 to 300 meters wide has been created, increasing the size of the atoll by roughly 11 times. An airstrip which runs almost the entire length of the reclaimed feature is also under construction, and the second airstrip is reportedly under construction at Subi Reef. Although China has an airstrip in the Paracel Islands, it is the only claimant in the Spratlys without one, bar Brunei, of course. These reclamations have come in for a lot of criticism. China has robustly rejected those criticisms and offered three rationales to explain what it is doing. The first is that because China has indisputable sovereignty over the South China Sea atolls, it has the right to undertake any activities it deems necessary on the features without interference or protest from other countries. The second rationale that China has put forward is that, well, we're simply doing what the other claimant countries have been doing for the last few decades. The third rationale is that the facilities under construction are primarily, emphasis on primarily, to improve the living conditions of personnel stationed on the atolls, and that the facilities will allow China to provide public goods, such as search and rescue services, disaster relief, marine scientific research, weather forecasting, and typhoon shelters for officials. These three rationales have been met with some skepticism by countries outside of China, particularly in Southeast Asia, where I live. And four other reasons have been put forward to explain what the real purpose of these reclamations is. The first is strategic. The harbors on these man-made islands will enable the Chinese Navy and Coast Guard vessels to conduct round-the-clock presence missions in the South China Sea without the need to return to mainland China for reprovisioning and refueling. Radar and satellite communication systems will significantly enhance China's maritime domain awareness in the South China Sea. and enhanced surveillance capabilities and the stationary combat aircraft raised the prospect that China may declare an air defense identification zone over the South China Sea or parts of the South China Sea, as China controversially did in 2013 in the East China Sea. China has stated that it reserves the right to declare an ADIZ over the South China Sea, and over the past several months, Philippine and US military aircraft have been issued with verbal warnings to leave international airspace that is near or above these reclaimed features. This has been interpreted by some as a precursor to an ADIZ. Second, China will be able to strengthen its sovereignty and jurisdictional enforcing activities using warships and Coast Guard vessels operating from these artificial islands. In particular, Coast Guard vessels will be able to escort Chinese fishing boats, survey ships, and possibly drilling platforms operating within the so-called 9-9. The third reason is legal. The reclamations will not strengthen China's sovereignty claims in the Spratlys because under international law, a state cannot transform a submerged or semi-submerged feature into a rock or an island by reclaiming it. Of the seven features being reclaimed, three are probably rocks and therefore entitled to a 12 nautical mile territorial sea. But the other four are submerged or semi-submerged features, and at best, under international law, they will be entitled to a 500 meter safety zone. However, the important thing to bear in mind is that the reclamations will directly impact the Philippines' legal challenge to China's 9-9. When the Philippines submitted its case in January 2013, it asked the Permanent Court of Arbitration to make a determination whether the features that China occupied and were within its exclusive economic zone were submerged features, rocks, or islands. But the Permanent Court of Arbitration is no longer able to make that determination because essentially China has destroyed the evidence by reclaiming these features. The fourth reason that has been put forward is that these reclamations are designed to preempt a code of conduct between ASEAN and China. The two sides have been in talks for a couple of years now on a code of conduct. ASEAN has called for an early conclusion to a code of conduct, but China maintains that it is in no hurry to sign such an agreement. China's lack of enthusiasm for a code of conduct has led to speculation that it seeks to prolong the talks because it wants to expand and consolidate its position before concluding the code with ASEAN. So how have Southeast Asian countries reacted to these developments? Among the four ASEAN claimants, the Philippines has been the most vocal critic. That's because some of the features lie within the side its 200 nautical mile exclusive economic zone, and Manila has accused China of violating its sovereign rights, infringing the self-restraint clause in the 2002 Declaration on the Conduct of Parties, and preventing the Permanent Court of Arbitration from determining the status of the features which are under arbitration. Philippines has also accused China of seeking to exert de facto control of the waters within the so-called 9-9. Vietnam has not been as strident as the Philippines in its criticism of China, although it has protested the reclamations as a violation of its sovereignty and also a breach of the DOC. The Philippines has been reactive in pushing its ASEAN partners to adopt a harder line with China and had some limited success with that. The chairman's statement at the 26th ASEAN summit in April expressed serious concerns at the land reclamations and that they had, and I quote, eroded trust and confidence and may undermine peace, security, and stability in the South China Sea. This represents ASEAN's strongest statement yet on the South China Sea dispute, although, as usual, ASEAN did not name China directly, although it's quite clear which party they were referring to. America has also been very critical of the reclamation. Senior US officials have accused China of changing the status quo in the South China Sea, intensifying the militarization of the dispute, destabilizing the region, undermining international norms and rules, and violating the DRC. In response to the reclamation, the US has underscored its commitment to the so-called Asian pivot or rebalance, to strengthen alliances and partnerships in the region, and provide capacity building support for Southeast Asian navies so they can improve their maritime security capabilities. However, there have been growing calls within the United States for it to adopt a firmer line with China, possibly using ships and aircraft to challenge any Chinese declarations of territorial seas around the features that are being reclaimed or a South China Sea ADIZ. Such exercises are almost certain to provoke a robust response from China, and it raises the potential of dangerous confrontations between the US and Chinese militaries in the South China Sea. They also risk strengthening the Chinese narratives that America is to blame for rising tensions in the South China Sea, and could embolden hardliners within the government and the military who seek to restrict US access to the area. In conclusion, I think that these reclamations, or terraforming as I call it, are likely to reinforce negative trends in the South China Sea, which have been apparent for a number of years now, in at least three ways. First, they are likely to increase tensions between China and the Southeast Asian claimants, particularly the Philippines and Vietnam. The Aquino government will look, and has been looking, to strengthen its military ties with the US. And it will also, I think, strengthen the Philippines' determination to pursue its legal challenge against China's claims at the Permanent Court of Arbitration. The first hearings on that case are scheduled for the 17th of July. Tensions generated by China's island building could push the other claimants, especially Vietnam, into strengthening the defense infrastructure on the atolls that they occupy. Ongoing tensions in the South China Sea will also accelerate the arms buildup in Southeast Asia as regional states prepare themselves or possible contingencies in the area in an era of growing strategic uncertainty. Second, the reclamations have already sparked a war of words between the US and China, and tensions could escalate further if Beijing declares territorial waters around some of the features and or an ADIZ over the South China Sea. The US may seek to challenge these declarations by moving military vessels and aircraft to within 12 nautical miles of the artificial islands, or by flying through the Chinese ADIZ unannounced. Freedom of navigation exercises by the US military would increase the risk of close and potentially dangerous encounters between the armed forces of China and America, both at sea and in the air. Interesting, the reclamations have also triggered a debate within the United States on what US policy should be towards China, whether it needs to be fundamentally rethought, whether the United States should adopt measures that seek to challenge China's claims in the South China Sea. And I think this debate is likely to intensify as America prepares for presidential elections in November 2016. Third, China's activities in the South China Sea over the past 2 years, the oil rig crisis last year, and the reclamation, have led to a greater sense of ASEAN unity. In July 2012, you will remember that ASEAN was unable to issue a final communique because of the South China Sea dispute. But in May 2014 and in April 2015, the member states stood together and issued statements expressing serious concern at China's activities. Yet even as ASEAN looks more united, the reclamations will likely impede the conflict management process with China. And indeed, they call into question the efficacy of the DRC Code of Conduct process. In my view, the reclamation of 2,500 acres of land and the development of extensive military facilities on these man-made islands are wholly incompatible with the DRC's self-restraint clause. Moreover, the reclaimed features will enable China to become more dominant in the South China Sea before a code of conduct is concluded. ASEAN's inability to slow or halt these reclamations further undermines its claims of centrality in regional security archipelago. And on that note, President, I will end. Thank you.
Спасибо большое. Очень интересное, краткое, конденсированное введение в ту обстановку, в которой мы будем обсуждать все эти вопросы.